We're joined now from Canberra by the CEO of the National Irrigators Council, Steve Whan. Steve, not a great day for irrigators in northwest New South Wales.
Well, I actually think we can take a couple of real positives out of what's been happening. First of all, irrigators everywhere would want to see those accusations actually tested in court. There is, of course, a presumption of innocence that people need to remember, but if somebody has been doing the wrong thing, then we want action taken against them, because water theft hurts irrigators the same as it does every other community along the river. Now, the second positive I think that we should take out of it is that over the last 7 months, we've seen the New South Wales government and the federal authorities through the Murray-Darling Basin Authority take a number of actions to strengthen compliance. They've put a lot of additional resources in, they've implemented a number of recommendations and put in place an independent body in New South Wales to oversee compliance. Again, that's what irrigators want to see. We want to see the water going exactly where it's intended, so that those who pay for their water get the water that they have bought, and nobody else is getting something for free.
Do you know the families involved?
Not personally. I've obviously they're irrigators, but I've spoken to them in the past, but I don't know them personally. There are obviously two irrigation families out of what the ABS says is 9,500 irrigation businesses on the Murray-Darling Basin. So I think one of the things that the rest of the irrigators around Australia would want to say to the people watching is that don't judge them all on the basis of accusations against a couple, and remember those accusations still need to be proven.
Will the council provide those families any support, and in what form?
No, that's the families themselves will be managing their own defences. That's not within the resources of our council to do that. We've made it very clear that we have zero tolerance for water theft, and we want to see a Murray-Darling Basin plan succeed. We want to see a basin plan succeed which has the compliance measures in place and strict enough to ensure that the community has confidence in that plan. So, you know, those processes which are going on now will give those families the opportunity to back their case in the court, and I think that's a positive, because for them the long wait has also been very difficult, and I think everybody should welcome the fact that it's finally going to be resolved.
Yeah, Peter Harris says he will defend the charges. Do you know if the Barlows will too?
I would expect so. My understanding of the Barlows' position, and they can obviously speak for themselves, is that they feel that they were given permission to pump when they did, and they'll obviously need to take that through the courts. I can't give an opinion on that. Except to say that from a National Irrigators Council point of view, we want the rules enforced. And irrigators, I think, have had a pretty negative time from a compliance system which has let them down, as well as letting down the rest of the community. And we've been very pleased to see the New South Wales government taking very strong action to rectify that.
Environmentalists believe there are more cases of alleged water theft out there, given the huge amounts of water involved. And you mentioned 9,500 irrigation businesses along the Murray-Darling. That's a very realistic prospect, isn't it?
Is there an area of society that you could say there is nobody trying to do the wrong thing? I suspect there probably isn't. But what I do know is that the vast bulk of the water in the Murray-Darling Basin is in systems where it's very stringently metered. The Southern Basin, for example, has extremely high standards of metering. People in systems through southern New South Wales, northern Victoria and South Australia, that's where the bulk of the water is. So I think it's fair to say that the bulk of the water that's in the system is used fairly and where it's meant to be. In the Northern Basin, we also have a large number of regulated rivers, and you can be confident about what's happening on those regulated rivers. So in terms of proportions of water, we're probably talking about only a very small proportion of the water in the basin. But again, no theft is acceptable, and it is up to the governments involved in the basin to ensure that the compliance systems are in place.
So do you think more irrigators might be charged?
I have no idea. Really, it depends on the work that the governments do on compliance. One of the consistent things that irrigators have said to me over the last year, and particularly over the last 7 months, is that they want to see compliance officers on the ground. They want to see them coming and inspecting their pumps and their systems. They want people with local knowledge who understand what's going on in the system, because that's fair for everybody, and so that's what I'd want to see too.
In terms of reputational damage, how do you think this will affect ongoing discussions about the Murray-Darling Basin plan, which is under serious threat?
I think it's really important to separate two things. We want to get a Murray-Darling Basin plan in place which gives the rivers the chance to make an environmental recovery and which fits the agreements that were made in 2012. Now, it wasn't an easy agreement to make. There's compromises on all sides. So we want to see that put in place. At the same time, and forever, you will need to have ongoing compliance. So we shouldn't be suggesting that the basin plan be ditched because there's some compliance issues out there. We should be fixing those compliance issues so that we can meet the targets in the basin plan.
Steve Whan, we appreciate your time tonight.
That's a pleasure.